Okay, so let me begin. So I'll start by reminding you of certain facts and definitions. Okay. So recall that we had defined this Hilbert space of H of states. This is annihilated. Annihilated by B0 minus and L0 minus, and I'll introduce these notations today. So B0 plus minus in my notation will be B0 plus minus B0 bar, L0 plus minus will be L0 plus minus L0 bar, okay. And we'll also use C0 plus minus, which is half of C0 plus minus C0 bar. Okay, these will be the definitions we'll be using. So the our Hilbert space of states that we had introduced to begin with are all annihilated by B0 minus and L0 minus. Okay. Now in this Hilbert space, I introduce a grading based on the picture number. Okay. So Hn are the states carrying picture number n. And then I said that the Nebuchadnezzar sector states HNS, okay, will be identified with H minus 1. Okay, these are states which carry picture number minus 1. And the Ramon sector states, general off-shell Ramon sector states, will be the ones which carry picture number minus half. Okay. Now, one of the important information, okay, which I am not going to prove, but it's easy to verify. Okay, has to do with the Grassmann analogy of these vortex operators. Okay, which basically tells us whether a given vortex operator, okay, is a commuting vortex operator or anti-commuting. Okay, for example, if it has odd number of fermions, it will be anti-commuting. If it has odd number, even number of fermions, it will be commuting. Okay. And typically, the result that one finds is that if we look at the NS sector, okay, then the Grassmann analogy is even for ghost number even and odd for ghost number odd. Okay, and I should perhaps so that I'll considering only GSO plus sector, because all off-shell states will also have GSO positive GSO parity. Okay, so this is with GSO projection plus. Okay, in the Ramon sector, it's opposite. So this implies, for example, for physical states, okay, the BRST invariant physical states, which are always in the ghost number 2 sector, okay, will have the Nebuchadnezzar sector vortex operators will be commuting, and the Ramon sector vortex operators will be anti-commuting, and which is what you want, because Ramon sector should describe fermions and Nebuchadnezzar sector should describe bosons. Okay, now I'll start with a definition. Suppose we have a set of n states. Let's say start with a0 to an, which belong to HNS plus HR. Okay, which means that it can either be an NS sector state with picture number minus 1 or a Ramon sector state with picture number minus half. Okay. And let's suppose that with there are M NS sector states, M NS and N, which is capital N minus M, are states, okay, we'll define a bracket A0 to AN as follows. Okay. So this sum is over genus. Okay, this is a formal definition. So to any given order in perturbation theory, of course, you always stop at a finite order in genus. So sum over G, this is the string coupling. Okay, we put the weight factor of string coupling to the 2G. And then integral RG MN omega 6G minus 6 plus 2 M plus N of all these states. Oh, I should have not written, this is, should be capital N plus 1 minus M. Okay, because the number of states here is N plus 1. I have started from A0. This, I remind you, is the 1PI subspace. 1PI subspace of PGMN. Had I replaced it by the full section, this would have been the full off-shell amplitude involving the states A0 to N. Okay, because that's what you mean by off-shell amplitude. You take the genus at genus G, we integrate the corresponding omega, then weight, put a weight factor of G string to the power 2G, and then sum over all genus. Okay, so this would have been a full off-shell amplitude if this had been the complete section. Instead, we are using the 1PI subspace of the section, and hence, this will be 1PI amplitudes. So this describes off-shell 1PI amplitudes. Is this definition clear? Okay. Then we are going to define another quantity, okay, which is also going to be useful. So given states A1 to N in H, we define A1 to N, okay, this is a state in H. By the following relation. Okay. The relation is simple. Its inner product with any state A0 in H is given by A0 to N for every A, for every A0 in H. Is this definition clear? Okay, so you have to define, we are trying to define a state in the Hilbert space. Okay. And to define a state, because the BPZ inner product is non-degenerate, it's enough if we specify its BPZ inner product with every state in the Hilbert space. Okay. And this is the definition. Okay, its BPZ inner product with any state A0 in the Hilbert space is given by this bracket. This is just a number that I have already defined here. Okay. Now, I should also say at this point that even though we are applying it in a somewhat different context of 1PI amplitudes and for superstrings and heterotic string, okay, the structure is essentially borrowed from old work in string field theory, okay, in particularly the work of Barton-Zoeberg. Right? So, if you want to just learn about this structure, his article is the best article to read, which is the review references given in the slides which are on the net. Okay, are there any questions? Okay, so it turns out that these brackets, okay, have some very useful properties. Okay, and since we are going to use those properties, okay, I'll put up a slide containing all those properties and explain what these properties mean or what they signify. So the first property is simple. It just tells us that if we exchange the AIs inside the bracket, okay, you pick up a sign. Okay, that's just Grassmann nullity. Okay, if you exchange two odd objects inside the bracket, you pick up a minus sign. Second one, in fact, is the most important identity. Okay, I'm not going to prove it. It can be proven using conformal field theory methods. Okay. But I'll tell you the physical origin of this identity, right? What this identity represents. Okay. And what it represents is the following. So if you remember that we drew this picture, so this is our whole PGN, this is MGN, okay. And the 1PI subspace was something like this, so let me put MN. 1PI subspace was some subspace like this, RGMN. Now what was the important property of this 1PI subspace? Okay, it is that at the boundaries of these subspaces, okay, it smoothly joins over to some 1PR contribution built out of lower Riemann surfaces. Okay, Riemann surfaces have a lower genus or lower number of punctures. And that's the way, in fact, we define these 1PR regions. That we first built all the 1PR regions, and then whatever is left over, we put 1PR regions. Okay, we just interpolated by 1PR region. So the fact that the boundaries of RGMN, okay, have to be matched by some 1PR contribution, okay, that information is fully encoded in the second identity. Okay, so the second identity is the algebraic description of this geometric fact, okay, that the boundaries of RGMN are connected to 1PR contribution. Are there any questions? Okay, intuitively you can see that the left hand side, which has a single bracket, okay, that's like inserting QB gives a total derivative on RGMN, so it picks up boundary contributions. The right hand side has two brackets, right? You can see a square bracket inside, and then it's inside a big curly bracket. Okay, that basically says that it joins up with something, okay, which is a combination of two 1PI regions. I introduce this notion G, okay, which is going to be very useful. Okay, so G is an operator which is identity when you act on the nth sector states in the Hilbert space, and which is the zero mode of this picture changing operator that I introduced. So what was, this was just integral d w over w of the picture changing operator. Okay. So on the Ramon sector states, it acts as that chi naught, and this G appears in these various identities simply because the way we describe the gluing operation, okay, the definition of gluing compatibility was by inserting this chi, zero mode of the picture changing operator. Third identity is also reasonably simple to prove. Okay. Basically, okay, it's proven by writing it, so we have A1 to AK, and then G on A1 tilde to AL tilde. Okay. So what you do is that you replace this by a complete set of states. With G A1 tilde to AL tilde. Okay. And then you can write this as A1 to AK phi r, and then phi r c G A1 tilde to AL tilde. And then by suitable manipulation, you can show that it's actually symmetric under the exchange of A1 to AK and A1 tilde to AL tilde with some additional sign factors which I have written there. So the point I want to emphasize is that these identities can be proven for any matter superconformal field theory. Okay, it doesn't require assuming that we are working in a flat background in particular. Okay, if you have a Calabi-Yau, okay, it's exactly the same identities which hold there. Okay, even though the correlation functions themselves, of course, have to be calculated, the definition of omega, which involves a correlation function, that of course will change because you have a different conformal field theory in that case. Okay, are there any questions? So next I'll introduce the concept of string field. Okay, because if you are going to write down an action, okay, we have to write the action as a function of some fields. Okay, so how do we introduce string field? Okay. So here is a definition, an nth sector string field. Okay, the definition will begin looking very abstract, but then I'll explain how it's related to the usual fields that you are familiar with. So nth sector string field is a state which I'll call psi ns belonging to h minus 1 of Gauss number 2, okay, and GSO plus, okay, GSO plus will always be assumed, and an R sector string field is a state psi R of Gauss number 2. Now normally you are used to thinking of fields as being functions of space-time coordinates. So what do you mean by a string field being represented by a state? Okay, so what I'll try to explain is how are these abstract definition of string fields, okay, related to what you normally think of as fields. So this is done by choosing a basis of states in HNS. So suppose phi r is a basis of Gauss number two states in HNS. Okay, then since psi ns is an arbitrary state of Gauss number 2, we can expand it out as a linear combination of this type. Okay, this is a fixed basis of states, and you have the coefficients of linear combination which are calling AR. Okay. So when I say that a string field is represented by a state, okay, basically what I mean is that the dynamical variables in the nth sector are in one-to-one correspondence with these variables AR. Okay, these coefficients of expansion of the string field are the dynamical variables of the theory. Okay. Now, you still don't see a field, okay, but that you can see by noting that in this sum over R, okay, one of the thing that you have to sum over, or more precisely integrate over, is the momentum carried by the state. Right? This is a complete basis of states. Okay. So in particular, it's characterized by the momentum along the non-compact dimension, right? Because the state will be characterized by, let's say, what are the possible basis states, right? You can have psi mu. Okay, let's consider the bosonic case, okay, which you may be more familiar with. Okay, alpha mu minus 1 alpha tilde mu nu minus 1
k.
Okay, so you will, one of the terms will be something like this, h mu nu of k integral d26k. Okay, so h mu nu of k in that case will be the dynamical variables. Okay, this integral over k as well as sum over mu and nu are the summing over r. And you are now recognize that this is nothing but the Fourier transform of the graviton field. Okay, so when I say that these dynamical variables, the ERs are the dynamical variables, these are fields in this sense, that once you decompose this index r into a momentum integral and a sum over discrete set, okay, this momentum integral represents the usual Fourier integral, okay, and you interpret the corresponding coefficient as the Fourier transform of the field in the position space. Okay, and you can do this for every level. Okay, so there is a field for every level, for every possible index structure. Okay, you have a field. Yes. Yes, except that in the first quantization, you will not include the complete basis here. Right, you will restrict to some specific choice of basis which will eventually represent physical states. Right. But if you expand it out on a complete basis, right, without worrying about whether it's physical state, pure gauge state, or anything, then that's what gives you the string fields, right, the complete set of string fields. Okay. But this notation is useful because I'm going to write down everything in terms of psi ns. If you want to work in terms of explicit component fields, you have to just substitute for psi ns this expansion and carry out the expansion. Okay. But all the formulae will be written in terms of this psi ns. Similarly, we can expand psi r in a basis br, let us call it phi tilde r. Okay, this is the basis of states, basis in HR of Gauss number 2. No, we are all working in the small Hilbert space. So C0 is not there. I introduced this before, but I'll restrict to states which are in the small Hilbert space. I should have probably said it that whenever I'm defining HNS and HR, they're all in the small Hilbert space. And I introduced before, I mean, yesterday I used C, right? But it always came in as a difference, right? So it's always in the small Hilbert space. So none of the correlation functions ever go out of the small Hilbert space. Okay, this is a technical point that all the correlation functions that we'll be ever dealing with, okay, all involves only differences in the field C between two points. Okay, so you'll always get expressions. That involve C in the combination like this. Okay. And similarly, all the states that I'll be including here in this expansion, okay, will only involve derivatives of C, right? The vortex operators will never involve a C by itself, okay? It will only involve derivatives of C, there will be arbitrary number of derivatives. And this is what is normally referred to as a small Hilbert space of the CFT. Yes, it's like that, exactly, right? So, because we are writing on the 1PI action, right, I'll write a classical action, and they are the classical action, you have to just do tree-level analysis to get the S matrix elements, right? But in a string field theory, you would first write down a classical action, then you will quantize it. You will think of A's and B's are the dynamical variables, and then you have to quantize it. Okay, now, the A's are commuting variables. These are anti-commuting variables because we know that the bosonic fields are the fields which carry integer spin are supposed to be commuting, okay, and fields which carry half integral spin, which are the Ramon sector states, these are supposed to be anti-commuting. So let me write that down here. So AR, these are commuting or Grassmann even, and these are anti-commuting, okay, or Grassmann odd. okay, which basically means that both psi ns and psi r are Grassmann even. Okay, because if you remember, I told you that the vortex operator here is Grassmann even in the ns sector. These are carrying Gauss number 2. Okay, and you are multiplying it by a Grassmann even quantity. So this product is Grassmann even. Here the vortex operator is Grassmann odd, okay, but you are multiplying it by a coefficient which is also Grassmann odd, so the product is again Grassmann even. Okay, and this is going to be important. So the string field is always Grassmann even though it is representing the fermionic fields or the anti-commuting fields and bosonic fields which are commuting fields. Okay, are there any questions? Yes, because we're not flat, we have chosen some conformal field theory that describes a matter sector, right? And we are basically doing string field theory around that background. The background is fixed by what super conformal field theory you have chosen, right? So that provides the background. And so, I mean, the string fields equal to 0 will correspond to that background. Okay, so with this, I am now ready to write down the 1 pi effective action in the NS sector. Okay, I'll include the Ramon sector later. 1 pi effective action in NS sector. Okay, this is a 1 pi effective action in the sense that these generate the 1 pi amplitudes, and if we calculate the 3 level amplitudes from this 1 pi effective action, you get the full amplitudes in string theory. So because you are considering NS sector, it is only a function of psi, and here is the result. Well, we can put n equal to 1. So, see that I have told you the definition of this. So, I should have said that what this means is that this is basically n copies of psi ns inside. These are n copies. Okay, and for this to make sense, it's important that these are all Grassmann even. Okay, if they're Grassmann odd, then of course it will vanish. Okay. So what does this tell us? Okay, what this allows us to do is that it, given a set of ARs, okay, which means given a field configuration, okay, it tells you how to get a number, right? Because I have told you this is just a normal BPC inner product. And this I have told you how to compute, right, in terms of those integrals. Okay. And that's what an action is supposed to do, right? That given a field configuration, it's supposed to produce a number. Okay, and that's what it does. Okay, and you can see that this is indeed the generating function for the 1 pi endpoint amplitude, because this integral, this curly bracket after all was defined to, well, I have erased the definition. This curly bracket was defined so that it gives a 1 pi amplitude. Okay, are there any questions? How is? Oh, because the definition of the curly bracket involves omega, right? And that omega involves the correlation function. So that's how the background CFT enters. Now one can show, in fact this is an exercise which you can do, okay. And all that you need to do to prove this is to use those identities. Okay. You never need to know in fact what these omegas are, okay, and what the definition of this curly bracket is, okay. Just that those identities, okay, and the relationship between the curly bracket and the square bracket, okay, which defines square bracket in the first place, you can use to show that delta S is 0 for delta psi, this is infinitesimal, this is NS again, Q where lambda ns belongs to h minus 1, but it carries ghost number 1. Okay, it has to carry ghost number 1 because otherwise this doesn't make sense, right? Because this has ghost number 2, so it better carry ghost number 1. Okay. So this you can prove, you can just take that action that I have written down there, make an infinitesimal variation thinking of lambdas as the infinitesimal parameters, and you can show that delta S vanishes. Okay. And this is the infinite dimensional gauge transformation that I referred to earlier. Okay. Why this is a gauge transformation? Again, to interpret this you have to decompose lambda NS in a basis states. Okay, you choose some basis state phi hat r of h minus 1 of ghost number 1. Okay. So the CRs are the gauge transformation parameters. Okay. These are the variables which implement our gauge transformation. And again you can see that because the sum over r includes this integral over momentum, these are really functions of k or equivalent to functions of x, okay, by Fourier transform. So this is gauge, this is local symmetry. And this include in particular, if you look at the linearized transformation, where you just ignore these terms, okay, it includes linearized general coordinate transformation, okay, and also various higher spin gauge transformations. But what these terms tell us, okay, is the full version of those transformations, including quantum corrections. Because this, in defining this bracket, okay, we also have taken into account the quantum corrections, because the 1 pi action involves already contribution from loops. Okay, so you can think of this as a full quantum corrected version of the gauge transformations that we see in string theory. Yeah, roughly. Okay, except that the second term you can see, interaction term normally you think of as starting at cubic and higher order, right? Here the expansion starts at n equal to 1, and that's basically because on the torus, on higher genus surfaces, even the one point function is non-zero. Okay, but you can always choose to call it interaction term because these are of order gs, order g string. String tension, again, it's encoded in the correlation functions, right? The CFT correlation functions, of course, knows about the string tension and everything else. But at this abstract level, you will not see any other parameter. Okay, so next, we can ask for equation of motion. That you can derive from this one PI action. Okay. And that basically means that you vary your psi ns infinitesimally and demand that the first order term variation will always give you 0. Okay. So again, this is an exercise. You can check that the equations of motion take the following form: QB on psi ns plus now, you notice that here the expansion begins at n equal to 1. Okay, that is a simply a reflection of the fact that here the sum begins at n equal to 1. Okay, and this happens because the linear, there are linear terms in psi ns, because on Riemann surface, a general Riemann surface, even the one point function of a generic field of this kind is non-zero. Okay, this is typically always true. Okay, you can always find operators whose one point function on the Riemann surface is non-zero. Okay, it's only on the sphere at tree level that the one point functions are all vanish. Okay. So which means that there is an n equal to 1 term here, which is a constant piece, right? Which is just this, no psi ns inside. Okay. And that means that psi ns equal to 0 is not a solution to equation of motion. It's a solution at tree level. Because at tree level, the expansion starts at order psi ns cube, but not otherwise. Okay. So even to find the vacuum, okay, the normal translation invariant vacuum, you have to do some work. Okay, you cannot simply take this action, expand it around psi ns equal to 0 and start calculating tree level S matrix. Okay, you have to first find the vacuum, then expand the action around the new vacuum, okay, and then from there you can calculate the tree level S matrix elements, which will give the full string amplitudes. Is this clear? Pardon? Of the 1 PI action. Because you're given a 1 PI action, right, in a like in a quantum field theory, you are supposed to do tree level analysis, but you have to expand around this extremum. Right? Otherwise, the tree level amplitudes don't make sense, right? You will get tadpoles if you don't expand around the extremum. Okay. So the first task, if you want to do anything with it, okay, the first task is that you have to find a vacuum, the vacuum solution. And this you can do, try to do iteratively. Iterative solution for vacuum. Okay. Vacuum means zero momentum, right? So you basically only look at states which carry zero momentum. Okay, you just solve this equation in the zero momentum sector because you want translation invariance. Okay. So here you can prove the following, that suppose psi k solves equation of motion to order gs to the k. Then you can show that we can find a solution to order gs to the k plus 1, okay, to, when you say, I say it solves equation of motion to order gs to the k, that means the equation of motion possibly has a correction as error terms of order gs to the k plus 1. Okay, the order gs to the k term in the equation of motion vanishes. Then we can find a solution to order gs to the k plus 1 of the following form. Okay, I should introduce some notation. Let me write it here. So P will be the projection operator to L0 plus equal to 0 states. Okay, L0 plus, let me remind you, is L0 plus L0 bar. Okay. All states are have L0 minus equal to 0. And I am introducing an operator P which projects into L0 plus equal to 0 states. Okay, it will become clear why. So the solution takes the following form. Now I should, sir, even though I am saying here n equal to 1 to infinity, okay, in actual practice you only have to stop at a certain order because the psi is already of order gs, right? And you are only trying to compute the solution to a given order in gs. So this upper limit is not really infinity, okay, but I am writing it as infinity anyway. You just pick whatever, to whatever order you have to go for a given solution. Plus, okay, so what is phi k plus 1? Phi k plus 1 satisfies P phi k plus 1 is equal to phi k plus 1. Okay, that means it says L0 plus equal to 0 state. Okay. And it satisfies the following equation, QB on phi k plus 1. So I'll write it there. So QB phi k plus 1 is okay, so what you can show is that if psi k satisfies the equation to order gs to the k, then if you choose psi k plus 1 in this way, okay, then psi k plus 1 satisfies the equation of motion to next order. Okay, so this gives an algorithm to solve these equations iteratively. Now you can see the importance of having this projection operator P. In fact, the conventional string perturbation theory, if you translate it into the, in this language, okay, what it does is that it doesn't introduce this P and it doesn't have this separate factor. Okay. The danger there is that if this, if you didn't have this P, oh, it's not P, sorry, this is 1 minus P. Yes. Okay, and I think this is N minus 1. Put a one or n minus 1 factor. So if you didn't have this 1 minus p, okay, then the contribution from the L0 plus equal to 0 sector will have a divergence. Right? So you shouldn't expect a non-singular solution. You may be lucky. There may not be any L0 plus equal to 0 component of this. But if there is, okay, then you run into a divergence because there is a 1 over L0 plus sitting here. So the role of P is that we separate out the part which has L0 plus equal to 0 and treat this separately. Okay, that's this 5k plus 1, which has to be solved separately. So in the L0 plus equal to 0 sector, you have to separately solve the equation, and that is this equation. And then you add it back to psi. Is this point clear? Okay, so in other words, if you just proceed naively, okay, and that's what conventional string perturbation theory amounts to, okay, that will correspond to solving this equation iteratively without this and without this P. And the divergences, the tadpole divergences that I mentioned in my first lecture, that essentially is the divergence that you get because this may contain L0 plus equal to 0 state, which diverges here. That's the 1 over k square equal to 0 that you saw. Now, of course, we cannot hope to create magic, right? If a theory had a tadpole, you cannot get rid of it by just changing the formalism. Okay? So how do you see possible existence of tadpoles? Okay? So possible existence of tadpoles must come from some kind of obstruction to solving these equations. Okay? Now, this is, of course, this part is straightforward, right? Once you have removed the L0 plus equal to 0 states, this is completely unambiguous. Okay? So there is no confusion in what this object is. The possible obstruction may come from the inability to find a solution to this equation. Right? This is an equation which tells a qb on phi k plus 1 equal to something. How do you know that there is a phi k plus 1 which satisfies this? Okay. So the first consistency check that you have to perform is that because qb is nilpotent, we know that qb acting on this better give you 0. Right? If qb acting on this didn't give you 0, then there is no hope that you can ever solve this equation. Because left hand side, when qb acts on the left hand side, it's 0. But this you can prove in general, that as long as psi k satisfies the same equation at one lower order, qb acting on this is identically 0. Okay? This is an identity which you can prove. So at least that is not a problem. But even when qb acting on this is 0, doesn't mean that you can solve this equation. Okay? Because this equation may have components along non-trivial elements of the BRST cohomology. Okay? It can have components along states, okay? It can contain states which are annihilated by qb, but which cannot be written as qb on another state. Okay? And if those states ever appear in this right hand side, then you cannot solve this equation. Okay? So that's the way tadpoles appear in this formalism. Okay? You will not see a divergence because the way it's set up, you will never encounter a divergence here or anywhere else in the perturbation theory. Okay? But what you may fail to do is to find a vacuum solution. Okay? And if that fails, then that means that the theory is inconsistent. You give up at that stage, okay? But not at a stage where you suddenly find a divergence and then you declare the theory inconsistent. Okay. Now, this in fact is also suitable for discussing the vacuum shift problem. So, let me briefly discuss this. So, if you remember in the first lecture, I described an example where there is a potential for a scalar field of the following form, phi square minus, let's call it some chi square minus k gs square whole square. Okay, I wrote a complex field, but let's suppose it's a real field. Okay. So from the low energy effective field theory viewpoint, this has three solutions, chi equal to 0 and plus minus gs root k. Okay. One can ask, how will that show up there in this analysis? And the way it will show up there is that when you are trying to solve this equation, okay, you will find that it doesn't have a unique solution. Okay. To order GS, you will find that it has three solutions instead of one. Okay. So there will be three solutions for phi 1. And this you can check explicitly by working out this particular example. for phi 1, okay, at this order. But then of course you have to keep going, okay, you have to construct your phi 2, phi 3, etc. And then you discover that at some point the solution that starts with this, okay, one of the three solutions, okay, that solution develops a tadpole, which means that that solution runs into an obstruction at higher order, okay, because this has non-zero energy, okay, which essentially induces a dilaton tadpole. Okay. But the dilaton tadpole, of course, you don't see at this order, right? You will see it only at order gs to the 4. Okay. So once you try to solve the equation at order gs to the 4, you find that you cannot proceed anymore, okay, that you run into an obstruction of the kind where the right-hand side contains a physical state. Okay, contains a state which is BRST invariant, but not BRST trivial. Okay. And that's the way you see that only one of these three solutions can really be, or only two of these three solutions, these two, can be continued to higher orders, but not the one corresponding to this. Okay, so now let me go to Ramon's sector. So it turns out that for technical reasons, it's not possible to write down an action involving Ramon's sector and Ebbw-Schwartz sector states. Okay. However, this would have been fatal if you are trying to do a field theory, genuine field theory which you have to quantize, because having an equation of motion is not enough to quantize a quantum field theory. Okay. However, we are constructing in one PI action, okay, from which you are only supposed to do tree level amplitude. Okay, you are supposed to calculate tree level amplitude, and that is supposed to describe the full set of quantum corrected amplitude in string theory. Okay. So for calculating tree level amplitudes, it's enough to write down equations of motion. Okay, because after all, tree level amplitudes are nothing but solving equations of motion. Okay. So one can write down the equation of motion for NS and R sector states together, okay, and it has a very similar structure to what we wrote. So let's say we take psi as psi NS plus psi R, okay, just formally sum the two states, Ramon sector state describing this Ramon string fields and the NS string fields. And then the equation of motion takes the form QB psi plus okay, where G, let me remind you again, it's 1 acting on NS sector states and this 0 mode of the picture changing operator when it acts on Ramon sector states. Okay, so this is a simple generalization of what we had for NS sector. There, of course, you didn't have a G because when you are acting on NS sector states, you don't have a G. G is identity. So by decomposing this into the NS direction and R direction, you can get the equation of motion for the NS sector string fields and Ramon sector string fields. Gauge invariance is also simple to state. So gauge transformation that leaves this equation of motion invariant is this. Okay. Well, lambda now belongs to H N S plus H R, okay, and it has Gauss number 1. Both in NS and R sector. Okay. So this now includes, for example, local supersymmetric transformations. Okay, earlier lambda was in the NS sector, lambda I said includes general general coordinate transformation. Now it includes local supersymmetric transformations as well. Okay, and you can see manifestly that these equations of motion are invariant under these transformations. Okay, are there any questions? Yes. Well, the point is you are shifting background by string loop correction, so it's not necessarily described by conformal field theory anymore. Right? See, the one pi, the construction of the one pi action, of course, is based on conformal field theory. But once you have gotten the one pi action, you never have to go back to conformal field theory, right? Because you have already constructed your vortices. Now you can look for vacuum, okay, classical solutions which are not necessarily described by conformal field theory. Okay, like these two I described. These are certainly not conformal field theories in the conventional sense. Okay, so now let's look at how to calculate S matrix elements, okay, or renormalized mass. Okay. So suppose psi v is the vacuum solution. Okay. So what will you do? You will define a shifted field chi as psi minus psi v and write down the action in terms of chi, right? So instead of working with psi, you will work with psi v plus chi. Okay, and by construction, because psi v is a solution to equations of motion, you are guaranteed that this action, when you expand in powers of chi, will have no linear term. Okay, which was the problem, because having a linear term means you have a tadpole. Here by construction you have eliminated the linear term. Now since the equations are a little involved, let me just show the slides. So basically it turns out that it's simplest to introduce a new set of brackets in this form. Okay, it's constructed out of old brackets. Okay, if psi v was 0, then only the old bracket term will survive. But now you add a whole series of terms involving the vacuum solution. Again, I have written everything from 0 to infinity, but both in the analysis of psi v as well as in the sum, you always truncate. Right? You never go up to infinity because you're only working to a given order in string coupling. Okay. So this defines the new prime bracket, curly bracket. This defines the new square bracket. Okay. And this defines what we'll call a new BRST charge. Okay. QB hat is a new operator, still a linear operator acting on a state, but that involves all these psi v's. Okay. In terms of these, one can show very easily that the shifted equations take this form. Okay, so it takes exactly the same form as the original equations, except that all the brackets are replaced by prime brackets and QB is replaced by QB hat. Okay. In fact, there is something even more interesting, which is that these prime brackets and QB hat satisfy exactly the same identities that were satisfied by the unprime brackets and the QB. Okay, so essentially, the whole structure remains unchanged, okay, and whatever identities you are proving earlier in using the QB and the unprime brackets also hold with QB hat and the prime brackets. Okay, so but let me come back to linearized equation. So the linearized equation is QB hat chi equal to 0. Okay, why are you interested in linearized equations? Because the solutions to the linearized equations are going to tell us a mass spectrum. Right? You compute the mass spectrum of the theory by looking at the solution to linear equations. Okay. So this, in fact, turns out to have two kinds of solutions. Okay. The first kind, there are solutions which exist at all k, all momentum. Okay. These are of the form qb hat lambda. These are pure gauge. Okay, pure gauge, but not in the conventional sense. Normally you call declare qb lambda as pure gauge. Okay. Now this is pure gauge, but this is quantum corrected gauge transformation because you are really using qb hat. The second class of solutions are solutions which exist at spatial momentum. So spatial momentum square. So for these, minus k square gives you the physically normalized mass. These are the physical states. So this tells us how to compute the physically normalized masses once you have the 1pi action. In practice, of course, you don't really follow this route. Okay. What this tells us, okay, which I'll not have time to discuss here, what this 1pi formalism gives us is a very precise way, precise operation involving the full correlation functions on the Riemann surface, which allows you to extract what the physical masses are. Okay. So you never really have to construct the 1pi action explicitly, okay, but using this 1pi description, you can arrive at a precise algorithm of how to compute the physically normalized masses from the off-shell amplitudes. Are there any questions? Okay, so I'll not have time to discuss this in any detail, but one of the questions that we had raised earlier about was about the dependence on the section. Okay, that if we choose a different section, okay, how does the action change? Okay, how do the renormalized masses change? And I told you that under a different choice of section, the action gets redefined. Okay, that action is related to the action changes by a field redefinition. And so I'll maybe end by showing you the specific field redefinition. Okay, and here it is. Okay. That imagine that you have two different sections, okay, or two different 1pi sections. So one is called RGMN, the other one is called R prime GMN. And I'll take this to be infinitesimally close to each other. Then you can define this vector field u hat which connects r to r, r prime, and you can explicitly write down a field definition that relates the action that is based on the section r gmn and the action that is based on the section r prime gmn. Okay, so in a sense you can explicitly prove that the choice of section amounts to just a field definition, and hence the physically normalized masses or the S matrix elements do not change under this field definition. Okay, maybe my time is up, so I'll stop here.